It's not about technology. It's not about cyborgs. It's not about, it's all about curiosity, and it's all about our desire to understand.
You're listening to the Futures Podcast with me, Luke Robert Mason. On this show, we meet the scientists, technologists, artists, and philosophers working to imagine the sorts of developments that might dramatically alter what it means to be human. On this video episode, we meet CEO of Cyborg Nest, Liviu Babits. Now, Cyborg Nest is a company who aims to radically alter our senses by designing new organs, redesigning our sensory modalities, and allowing us each to individually navigate the world in vastly differentiated ways. It's also one of the first companies to create commercial devices that enable people to become cyborgs. So, Liviu, what is Cyborg Nest, and how does this organization hope to transform humanity?
So, as you said, Cyborg Nest aim is to enable people to have more senses. And the whole idea started when a coin dropped, when we realized that, hey, basically, if you think about it, everything that we ever felt, thought, or created started from a sensory input. Or to put it in another way, we are taught all our lives that our brain is the most important and sophisticated part that we have. But if you think about it, our brain without our senses, it's exactly like having the most sophisticated computer existing, but put in a corner of the room, not connected to electricity or connected to the internet. There will be absolutely no input and no output. So again, if I take away all your senses one by one, all you are left with is all the memories, thoughts, and things that you captured before that, but you have absolutely no ability to gather any kind of new input, like no more sounds, no more colors, no more touching, no more nothing, right? So the only information that your brain will get is from your internal organs, which most of it, we don't have any access to it, right? Except pain or I don't know, itching or stuff like that. So then we said, okay, so if we have more senses, can we as humans start thinking, creating, feeling, solving problems from places that we never did before? So that was like a big aha moment. And when that happened, we said, well, we just have to go for it.
Well, that's one of the fascinating things about Cyborg Nest. You're using the pre-existing senses and pre-existing organs to put new information into the brain. And one of the first ways you did that was with a product called the North Sense. So what was the North Sense? What is the North Sense? And what does it actually do?
Yeah, so after that first coin drop, the one that I was talking about, the next thing that we said is, okay, but what will be a sense that will be relevant for people, or what can we create? Because I'm not a hardware or a software engineer. Technology is not the aim of my life. I'm a user of technology, and through my life experience from my previous work and what I do now, what I care about and what we care about at Cyborg Nest is impact. So then we said, okay, what sense will actually have impact on humanity? And we started looking around us, and we saw that if you look in the last 100 years, everything that has to do with navigation, orientation, and proximity became such an important pillar of our life, yet we don't have any sense for that, and we are basically completely lost without our devices that can help us do whatever we need to do. Or if you look historically, if you were born 200 years ago near Marseille in France in a village, you would go to Marseille once in your lifetime, and that would have been it, right? But, you know, just we spoke before we started this interview, today we travel so much, we move so much, information, data is flying, everything is moving, and we are like, but where am I? Where is all that happening? So we said, okay, so we need a sense of orientation. So the North Sense, the idea of the North Sense was very simple. It had one simple feature that it was connected to your chest, and every time you face the magnetic field of the planet, which we call also North, basically, you get a little notification. And at that stage, the obvious question that people have is, okay, but dude, you know, I'm in like 2021, I have a compass on my phone. Like, why wouldn't I use the compass on my phone for that? We don't need to do all that. But there is a small but radical difference between the two, because one is a tool and the other one is a sense. And the difference between a tool and a sense is this as simple as the permanency of it. So none of us is going to take his eyes off when we finish this conversation. You're not going to take your ears off when you're like, okay, I'm done with the song, ears off, right? They're always on, and that's how we, and because they are always on, that's how we create what we call our perception of reality. That's how we understand the world that we live in. Because we don't choose which sounds to hear and which not, or when to hear them or when not. We don't choose when to see and what when not, or when to be touched or not. It's just always on. So a compass is something that you need to make a deliberate decision, cognitive decision. I need to use a compass. So you take it out of your pocket, you use it, and then you put it back, right? But a sense, the north sense, it was always there, and you're always sensing that thing. So suddenly having a permanent understanding of your orientation on the planet suddenly gets you to think about things that you never thought before, like, hey, so the direction that I'm facing now and the direction to the entrance to the school of my son and the way that I was going into my office when I was allowed to go to the office and my next meeting and all that connects into little maps in your brain that before that you were like, I didn't think about it. Or if you think about it in a different way, you would have never thought which color should my car be if you didn't have eyes, right? Because it wouldn't have been any kind of issue. It wouldn't have mattered. But now that you do have eyes, so you do think about it. So that was the North sense. And we started with something that was as simple as, because we wanted to see what is the impact of that one little input and how does that work.
Well, it reminds me very much of the way in which birds sense north when they migrate. And it feels like some of the things that you develop at Cyborg Nest are heavily influenced by the animal kingdom. Do you think human beings once upon a time maybe could intuit where due north was, and perhaps we've lost that ability because we've outsourced so much of that knowledge to our technology?
Yeah, so there are a lot of theories about it. None of it, as far as I know, has been really proven in any way. Mm. There are theories that say that we might have something leftovers of it in our eyes, in our nose, in our whatever. There are different things, and we might have had this sense to in the past, and we've lost it. But the way that nature was created and the place that we took it from there onwards are very different in a fundamental way, because senses in nature are there for survival, right? So a bird needs to know how to migrate so it survives the winter, because otherwise it will die. It will just fly into the next storm. And for us, because we were not migrating, it was probably not that important for us to have this sense of orientation. So if we did have it, then we've lost it because it wasn't that important. But we since then, we as a species, as humans, moved away from that survival point. Today, you don't use your eyes to see if a herd of buffaloes is coming to destroy your house, right? And you don't use your nose just to make sure that your house is not on fire, and you don't use your sense of touch just to see that you're not freezing. You use your eyes to watch a movie, you use your nose to enjoy a meal that you're eating. So we stepped away from that survival place. And this is where Cyborg Nest is coming in. We are not coming to, yes, we are taking inspiration from nature, and nature is our kingdom and our mother, let's call it. But there are differences in the species and in the way that we perceive and we use our senses. So we didn't create the north sense or a sense of orientation because otherwise we're gonna die. We created that because we need it, and the way that we designed life in the 21st century going onwards, it's something that will be needed for us as a species.
So North Sense was essentially this small device that you had pierced onto your chest. And what it allowed you to do was sense north from this vibration. But for you personally, how did having something pierced onto your skin that vibrated every time you faced north. How did that change the way you thought about the limitations of your own body?
It's really amazing. You know, it was actually a really interesting conversation because when we started Cybernest and before I had the North Sense, and we started doing pre-orders to the device, and people asked us, so how am I going to feel? What's going to be the difference? and I was like, I don't know. Like, I have no idea.
I don't know.
But that's like, I never had another sense. It's not that like, trust leave you. I had 20 new senses before that, and I know how all that stuff works. I'm going to tell you. No, and we were very frank and very honest about it. And it wasn't a place of shame. It was a place of exploration, and it was a place of we together with the community going forward and creating together and exploring together. So that unknown was an unknown that was, you know, to all of us. But today, after having the North Sense for I've had it on myself for 2 years, that feeling, you know, when I at some stage I had to take it off, and today I have the Sentero that we are already testing, so I have my sense back. But in the period between when I did not have the sense, I didn't die, right? So it's not that like, oh no, I'm dead, but it's like you wake up in the morning, and I'm sorry for everyone that is colorblind, but it's if you're not colorblind, suddenly you wake up in the morning and everything that used to be orange is not there, and you're like, I can live with that, but why isn't it there? Like, why isn't my brain getting that information? Because you are used to constantly, permanently get that information, and suddenly it's not there. So you're like, I want that. I need that back into my life.
Well, it feels like some of this technology works through the process of neuroplasticity. And we've had Dr. David Eagleman on the podcast talking exactly about how that process works. So do you feel like something like the North Sense is a device, or in the way in which you've described it there, does it now feel more like something like an organ?
It definitely feels like an organ, and the whole design and the whole feeling and the whole the way that we look at what we do is to create new organs for people. And you mentioned the piercing and the invasiveness as well. In the beginning, that was also part of the equation, but it was very clear throughout the journey that there were two very distinct experiences with the North Sense. One, the cognitive one, which is everything that I told you up until now. And then there was the physical one, which was the piercing. And that wasn't comfortable and that wasn't successful. So for now, we've decided to drop that and to say, let's focus, because we are not a medical company to create implants. That's not our aim. I don't have any fetish for implants. It's not my interest in life. My interest is to really create new organs for people. And when the day will come and technology will be, let's say, there for us to be able to really create those senses. And, you know, my dad, actually, he intuitively said a very smart sentence that I won't forget. He said, the moment I can go to Boots or to a pharmacy and buy myself an implant, go home and implant it to myself, then that's the day I'm going to get an implant. But as long as it has to do with body piercers, doctors, blood, healing, whatever, I'm not into that, right? And I think that is probably kind of the common feeling that people will have about this stuff. So we felt that there is no point in pushing into that direction too much, and what matters is really to focus on the connectivity between the technology and the human brain, and that's what we focus on now.
And has that feedback from your early adopters, has that informed the creation of Sentero, which this device is wearable? It's not something that has to be necessarily pierced onto the body. I just wonder how that feedback from those early adopters has helped to inform the way in which you've thought about developing these new organs.
Yeah, so it's exactly as I mentioned, because in the beginning people are like asking me, or I was asking myself, how is that going to feel, or what's going to be the feeling? And then you have it, and then in the beginning you're like, okay, it's I feel it all the time. And then there are different stages of the process that the brain goes through when it let's say adopts this new sense. But then at some stage, you're like, okay, so now I figured out that this direction, it's exactly the direction of my son's school. But can I actually feel my son, right?
Mm.
So then you're like, oh, I can sense people, right? Or I was during all this traveling, I started using the North Sense for part of my navigation throughout cities that I don't know. It could obviously not get me to a certain exact address, but it could help me understanding directions, general directions, right? Because if I knew that where I need to go is like northwest, so I could obviously go into that direction. But then I said, wait, but we can actually feel where people go. So that whole loop that, if you remember from the first question where I said that everything that we created, thought or felt, started from a sensory input. So that starts to happen because you get a sensory input that starts to suddenly trigger your brain. And then we were like, okay, it can help blind people and it can help people with dementia and it can be amazing in gaming. And then a dude built an app for pictures that when you look at pictures, it connects you to the direction where they were taking, and suddenly all these thoughts that we and the community had, you know, made the Centero happening and will continue making everything happening onwards. Yeah.
I mean, what you're doing is commonly known as biohacking. And the wonderful thing I love about biohacking is that community. They are so key to the development process of these devices because they're very open about giving that sort of feedback. So have some of these applications of both the North Sense and soon to be Centero, have they surprised you? Have they informed you? Have you found some really exciting ways people are leveraging their new senses?
Absolutely. It's because it's a matter of personality, you know, our senses and everything that we have taps into our personality, or our personality taps into senses. It's probably a kind of a dual way of going. But for example, you know, I have a microphone at home because my son is a musician. I'm not a musician, so I love music and all that. But my ears are not as important for me as they are for my son, right? For a graphical designer, his eyes are the main thing in his life or her life, right? So we all use our senses in different ways and in different things. Yes, we all use the eyes not to get run by a car when we cross the road. That's like, there are common stuff that is what brings us back to why nature gave us the senses. But beyond the survival place, we all use it in different places. I don't watch TV. My wife does watch TV, right? So it's a choice. So then also the ideas that people have come from their own personality. So today we have plans with so many and, you know, so many things to do in the future with the Centero, and exactly with different companies or organizations or individuals that come and say, hey, I want to do it for that and I want to use it for this. And, you know, so it's really exciting because it's every day we bump into or a new idea comes or people come with ideas and it's all happening together. Yeah. But I have a funny story about biohacking. Do you want me to tell you?
Yeah, please tell me.
Yeah. So about 2-3 years ago, so after the North Sense was released to the market, there was an absolute boom in the media about Cyborgnest, and that boom was followed by us being invited to speak at endless conferences. And then at some stage, I got to a place where I completely lost connection of where I am, where I'm going, what kind of talk it is, you know, just like a machine, getting on a plane, getting somewhere, doing the talk, going home. And then one day I get to Finland and the conference was at a biohacking center. And as far as I was concerned back then, biohacking was about technology and humans and all that. And then I get there, I look at the list of speakers and I see, bloody hell, there is absolutely no one speaking here about technology except me. So what the hell are they talking about? Like, what is biohacking to them? And it was an absolute life changer for me because on a personal level, but also on an understanding level, because when I realized that, I suddenly sat in the room and I listened to all the talks, like the people that came to listen to the talks. And I deeply understood the world of biohacking and what that means and how you can basically take control of your body and your mind from so many places. So again, on a personal level, today I'm a biohacker, not only because I'm the dude who runs the company that creates new senses for humans, but I'm like a huge practitioner of the Wim Hof method. Just behind me here, there are like 15 bottles of supplements that I take every day. I do sports, I do meditation every day. So it completely changed my life. And I think it all comes as a package that we will all be part of it one day.
Do you think eventually we're all going to have to become biohackers? Do you think the way in which we mainstream this process of biohacking is because we're going to realize the best way to live is to design our own morphology, to design the ways in which we want to navigate the world, and to design the ways in which we want to enhance our health?
Absolutely, because it's all rooted in our curiosity, and it's the curiosity and what you can do with that curiosity, right? So if you're a super curious person and you have a stick in your hand, so you can do amazing stick stuff with that stick, but there is only a certain amount of stuff that you can do with one stick, right? But then if you are a curious person and you have a stick, a ball, a rope, and a chair, suddenly you're like, holy moly, maybe I can actually build something out of it. I don't know, something that I can jump with, or a fitness thing or whatever, right? So that's what happened to us as humans. Thousands of years ago, we had very little stuff to work with. So we continue developing. So today we got to a place where, because of the internet and the amount of knowledge that we have and the amount of stuff that we develop, that we can really go into those, let's say, new places or deeper places. But, you know, every generation likes to think that they are the most, the craziest, and the nastiest and whatever. So we think that about ourselves, but I'm sure that my son's generation will take it a step further, and what I'm doing will be like, ah, so your dad was the one that did that thing on your chest. Ah, that's so old, right? Because it's going to happen. And it's fine. It's part of the process. So not only that, the short answer is yes, the bigger answer is that we can't even think about how further than that people will take it, and people will take it.
I mean, why do you believe so passionately that it's important to design these new senses? Because some people may look at what Cyborg Nest are doing and think, well, what's the point? My body has evolved to deal with the environment that I live in. Why do I need an extra sense or a new sense or a sense enhanced?
So there are a few ways of looking at it. First of all, again, we go back to the core of our existence and the difference between us and, I think, most of the species. It's hard to say if all of them, because it's really hard to understand what's happening in most of the animals' brains. But the one thing certainly is the level, the curiosity that we have is not something that we can stop. Right. And it's not something that we can think about it. If we didn't have eyes, we would have never thought that those things there are like are those lights are planets. And then, you know, we wouldn't have never thought that, hey, should we go there? Can we go there? Right. There is absolutely. It's that place, and I always speak about, you know, people that went to space. Is there a reason to go to space? No. Were we meant to fly? No. Were we meant to leave our atmosphere? Absolutely not. More than that, the atmosphere is built in a way that you bloody burn if you try to go through it, right? So it even tells you, no, don't do that because you're going to die, right? But still, like 50, 60 years ago, there were a bunch of people who sat in a metal tube with gallons of fuel under it and said, light that shit up, we are going, right? And they went, and they had no fucking clue how that thing is going to end or what's going to happen. So that's the essence of our existence, and we can't stop that. It's not about technology, it's not about cyborgs, it's all about curiosity, and it's all about our desire to understand, and our desire to think, and our desire to create, and our desire to be. And that is why we do need, let's say, all that, although need, it's a very harsh word.
I mean, the entire history of science could be reduced to two pieces of technology that have changed the way in which we use our senses, the telescope and the microscope. They fundamentally transformed what the eyes could do. And at Cyborg Nest, you go one step further and you say that you believe in technology that empowers us to design our evolution. So hasn't technology always guided our evolution, and haven't we always co-evolved with our tools and machines?
Absolutely, and I'm happy that you say that, because usually the, let's say, way of looking at stuff that I hear most of the time is, why do we need to merge with technology? And I'm like, but wait. This whole merging with technology is not a question, it's a fact. Yes, all the questions about privacy and all these big topics that everybody speaks about today, they are so relevant and super important. And as a dad, I'm also super aware of it, because I have a little kid that I need to protect, right? But our relationship with technology started thousands of years ago. If you look, there are many philosophers or history looks at stuff that, you know, first there was humanity, then there was technology, then we merged, and because of that, we survived. And when I say merge with technology, it's not the IBM computer in the 70s, but it's the stick with the fire, right? Or it's the wheel that we invented. That is the first stages of technology. And we know today that, you know, there were different types of kind of human-like species that evolved parallel to us, and the reason we survived is because we adopted technology and they didn't, right? So it's not about us merging with technology now, but now people are like, you know, because we had technology was somewhere there and we were here, and then there was the PC and then the laptop and then the smartphone, and then Live You comes and says, hey, why don't you put it on yourself? And people are like, whoa, we need to speak about it, right? But it's not that what we need to speak about it. It's about what do we do with your data that we need to speak about it. It's how we treat you, you know, like, we don't call people in our company customers. You're not my customer. Mm. You're part of a community. You're part of something that we build together. You know, it's these kind of things that are need to be spoken about. It's not, you know, funny enough, but today suddenly, because there is whole thing happening now with Facebook that everybody's leaving WhatsApp and moving to other groups and all that. And suddenly I was like, how come, you know, a company like Facebook, for example, always pushes us to share more about everything. But if you think about it, we've seen Mark Zuckerberg's son less than we've seen Kim Jong-un's son, right? So he keeps him so protected, or daughter. I don't even remember what he has, because we never see him never or her, right? So that's the type of things that will not happen in Cyborg Nest. I will not ask you to have a nonsense pierced in your chest, and I will sit aside and say, well, that's fun, right? That's cool. No, we were the first to go and do that. We are part of it. So I think that's the changes that are happening. It's not about the technology itself, yeah.
That's what I love about your work and the work of Cyborg Nest, is that what you're trying to do is fundamentally redefine this idea of cyborg. Because when we think of cyborg, we think of the Terminator, and we think of these mid-90s visions of having to plug into computers and upload our minds into machines and merge with machines like the Borg in Star Trek. But what you're doing is much more informed by, oddly enough, two artists, the work of Neil Harbison and the work of Moon Ribas, who I know were key to the early stages of the Cyborg Nest thinking and the Cyborg Nest development. And what's wonderful about Neil and Moon is that they created their own organs. In Neil's case, he has this antenna which allows him to hear color, and it's not quite that. What it's doing is it's transforming light waves into sound waves and then vibrating his skull and creating this entirely new sensory experience. And yep. So much so that he now talks about dreaming in sonochromatic dreams. It's become so much part of him that if I went up to Neil and I tried to touch him on the eyeball on the antenna, he would recoil as if I came up to you and tried to touch you on your nose. So these individuals, they became profoundly embodied with the devices that they created in the way in which Andy Clark describes in Natural Born Cyborgs, the idea of profound embodiment. It feels like what you're trying to do is less about connecting with hyperthreading processes of modern connectivity and more about reconnecting with the animal kingdom, with nature, and more, most importantly, with ourselves.
Absolutely. You know, it's exactly, again, as we spoke before this conversation, I absolutely know nothing about tech on that level. I'm not a tech fan. It's not my thing. And you can ask people in my team. I'm an absolute idiot in those fields. But really the idea is to try to push into how can we create positive impact? How can we create a world where we enjoy and we experience and we have a richer life experience? I don't care about a new chip that comes to the market and can run twice faster than the previous one. I know nothing about it. The users and people, you know, out there should not care about that. You know, it's not like, so it's all about really connecting to nature. And then, you know, it's funny, and it's not by accident that it's happening exactly at times where we understand what we are doing to the planet by the actions that we are doing and the importance that our planet has for us as a species and for our existence. So, you know, we think about it this way. We would have never understood the disaster that global warming is causing if we didn't see the glaciers in Iceland melting, right? But suddenly you're like, you get a picture of a piece of ice that was here and 5 years after it's here. So you're like, holy shit, what happened here, right? Where is that? Where did that go? So our senses not only help us to enjoy, but they help us to also understand like where we live, what is happening, what part of what are we? So that's why companies like Cyborgnest exist. It's not about the technology. That's not the aim. That's not the passion. The passion is humans. You know, again, I'm a dad. The last thing that I wish is to wake up in the morning and to see my beautiful son as a robot. Like that's not the aim. And I don't think that will happen because you know, it's science fiction and things that people write. It's many times serving few things. First of all, to open people's ideas about stuff, but also to warn us about, hey, that could actually lead to that. So it doesn't mean that if we create cyborgs, we are going towards the Terminator. It means that we've learned from the Terminator not to go into that direction exactly. And we are trying to do something that is exactly the opposite, right?
Well, as a biohacker, when you see something like Elon Musk's Neuralink, do you get excited or do you get slightly cynical about those sorts of projects?
First of all, every person that tries to push boundaries, I'm very excited and very supportive about. Specifically about Elon Musk, I think, you know, there are some stuff that the guy said in the last few years that ethically we completely do not align about, you know, about women, about, I don't know, some stuff that he put there on Twitter when he didn't think what he's writing. But one place that I felt very uncomfortable with is the last time that they did their live stream about the thing with the piggy, right? So it was nice to see. It wasn't such a huge technological advancement. But I was just for doing that, I was still proud of him so he did that. The place where I completely lost him is after the demonstration when he started promising blind people that he's going to make them see, or starting promising people that can't walk that he's going to make them walk. I would never do that. I would say, I don't know where we are going. We are exploring, and let's explore together. And together we will find how we use that in the best way. Because the moment he said those sentences, I felt like, because I put myself suddenly in the place of someone in a wheelchair, listening to the guy and saying, I might walk, right? And the reality is that dude is probably not going to walk. Not in the next few years, that's for sure, right? So those are the places where I feel, yes, you need to throw the hook very far and to aim to somewhere to get there, right? And yeah, going to Mars or whatever, yeah, that's so cool and so nice. But I would not go and touch places that are so painful for some people and to say, I'm going to solve you that until you know that you're going to solve that.
Well, what's so wonderfully egalitarian about the biohacking community is they actually just use themselves as the laboratory, as you've used yourself as a laboratory. And I guess, what have you found with some of those scientific experiments that you performed on yourself?
That I think that's the only way to go. You know, I was I have such an eclectic life experience, but one of the other things that I did in my life is to be an officer in the army. And when you have a life responsibility on people's life, you can't sit in your armchair and say, go there, do that, right? You need to be the one that says, follow me, and not I follow you after you go, right? So I'm always going to be the first, and I will expect my team to be the first people to do whatever we offer other people to do and to know what's happening. And yes, we will throw the hook far and try to aim very far, but there are ethical limits that we will not cross, like promising someone that can't walk that he's going to walk, or promising someone that can't see that he's going to see, because we are not even close to there. So you know, a self example is I think it's such an important thing in life. It's exactly what I said about Mark, right? If you own that huge company, one of the biggest companies, that is about sharing, which I don't think it's a bad thing, the sharing part, right? Mm-hmm. Why don't you share yourself? Like, where are you, bro? Like, the world wants to see you. Like, you can't sit in your armchair and ask us to share, but to protect yourself behind every wall possible. Right, just because you're Mark Zuckerberg. So that's the places where I think people are not going to eat that kind of shit anymore, right? So people are going to say at some stage, and don't get me wrong, I don't have anything specific against Facebook. I'm just using different examples of how things should happen, because at the time, Facebook were amazing with the thing that they did in the beginning. But I think everything that happens, the next generation needs to do it slightly better and slightly better and slightly better. So this is where we come and we say, okay, we've seen Apple, we've seen Google, we've seen Facebook, we've seen Amazon, we've seen all those, and they are all amazing and we all use them, but there are places to improve and we can improve. And one of probably the most important places to improve stuff is the ethical part of it.
I mean, again, that's another thing that I just love about Cyborg Nest. You're not attaching these devices to people so you can extract data from them to then sell that data to marketers. You're giving people the power to create sensors for themselves and change the way in which they experience and navigate the environment. But if we have a multitude of individuals using either Cyborg Nest devices or devices of their own creation to change the way in which they interface with the world, do you think we're going to start ending up with a society where we have a multitude of differentiated humans with multitude of differentiated senses? I mean, if that's the case, how will we be able to communicate effectively between each other if one person has an antenna, another person has a vibration sense that allows them to do something
else? But isn't that problem the exciting part, actually? Uh-huh. It might get to that place, right? But isn't that the exciting place where we would need to continue to reinvent ourselves and develop ourselves? You know, we've been, if you look at the history of communication, for example, we started from drawing things on caves, Right. And after that, we said, well, but that if I want to leave my girlfriend a note to until I draw the whole mammoth and the thing on the cave, it takes a lot of time. So maybe I'll just write a few letters and I'll tell her, when you see these signs, it means that I love you. Right. So L-O-V-E. And then we started writing. And then the guy said, maybe I'll write her a poem and then I'll write her a book. And then suddenly you had people like Dostoevsky that wrote books that are that thick, right? But from that moment onwards, because life has changed again, we started kind of like a parabola going backwards, because we started from Dostoevsky. Suddenly it was articles, and then it was emails, and then it was texts. And today, if you send someone a text, why are you sending me a text? Send me an emoji, bro. Right? So we are back basically to the place of writing on the caves, but instead of doing the drawing on the cave, you do it on the phone, and it means the same thing. So we continue moving and evolving. And I think situations like you are talking about, yes, it might happen, but isn't that interesting? Isn't that fun? Where would that lead us? How will we exactly, as you say, how will we communicate? What? Yeah, it's fascinating.
Well, it was Neil Harbison who first alerted me to this possibility with some of his artwork. So he has this antenna which allows him to hear color, and he creates these incredible sonochromatic art pieces. And to me, as someone who is not wearing or is not implanted with an eyeball, all I see are these incredibly beautiful, colorful
squares.
Yeah. But for Neil, he's hearing these beautiful, incredibly sonic squares. For him, his experience of the artwork is completely different.
Yeah, but that's exactly those places which are so fascinating and so interesting. And so, you know, you're like, holy moly, I can understand stuff in different way. And it's not just that, but first is the curiosity. You know, you see a closed door. So for us as humans, the first intention is, I want to open that door because I want to know what's happening there, right? And then you gather the courage. You either create the key or get the key or whatever, and you open the door and you expose the door and you get there. And that's the first excitement, right? And that's the place where we are talking exactly about the drawings with Neil Harbison. But then the question is, the main question is not the excitement of the finding, is what we're going to do with that and how that is going to impact our life, right? Because the moment we understood that everything in the world has patterns, right? And everything is basically a big mathematical equation. It wasn't that changed our life. It's what we did with that changed our life, right? So it's those places that slowly we curve into the stone, and we get to another place and to another place and to another place and to another place, and luckily it's infinite, so it's going to be fun forever.
Well, what's interesting again about the sorts of devices that you create is that it's going to be fun forever, but for it to be fun requires patience, because these devices require a little bit of adaptation. As soon as Neil put on the eyeball, it wasn't a case of him suddenly having this new sense.
No.
He had to wear it for almost 10 years before he started to get these sonochromatic dreams. And it feels like duration is the key to the adaption of this new technology. It's not like getting a new iPhone. It's not something you're going to switch on and suddenly
it's
you've got this brand new sense.
It's not the plug and play, isn't it? And it's that's exactly it's those twists in life, because I think I grew up exactly when that notion of plug and play was invented, and suddenly
it's more like plug and wait.
But you know, I remember like 10, 15 years ago, they used to actually write on devices if it's a plug and play or not. And whatever wasn't a plug and play, you wouldn't have bought that, because like, I don't want that shit because it's not plug and play, right? And you would have thought that from that moment onwards, it's just going to get more plug and play. So even plug and player. And then suddenly it's going to a place where people like Neil Harbison or ourselves come and say, wait, actually, it's exactly the opposite. It's, as you say, it's plug and wait, right? So it's twists in the journey, and it's stuff that we can't really predict and think. And it is part of the fun. It's part of the process. It's part of the creation. And to be honest, a bit of patience will not do bad to any of us these days, isn't it?
Well, people get very excited about this idea. Oh, I can become a cyborg. I can become this science fictional vision that I have in my head. But as a CEO of a company that creates cyborgs, how do you manage those sorts of expectations?
It's just being honest with everything as much as you can. And also being nice. I think that's also so important, you know, like... I'm sorry if there was any case, but I think there was never a case of anyone wrote us an email and we didn't reply, or anyone asking a question and we didn't reply. Even if we said we don't know, and saying don't know, it's so important sometimes, you know, and just being nice, because I think what some people forget is that maybe most of your life you're a CEO of a company, but there is that moment when you go to the corner shop and you want to buy something, and then suddenly you are the client. And if the guy behind the counter is a dick and is not nice to you, you're like, you're a dick, you're not nice to me, right? So why should I be a dick to people, right? We always need to be humble enough and just be nice, be honest, be nice to people.
In many ways, I see Cyborg Nest really as the pioneers of commercially available cyborg devices. But by paving that way, what you've actually enabled is a whole bunch of individuals to come into this space and create insidables, injectables, embeddables, wearables. I mean, what do you think is the future trajectory of biohacking devices and the sorts of companies that want to create biohacking devices?
I hope ethical. Let's start with what I hope. And beyond what I hope, it's, listen, everything that we ever created as humans has pluses and minuses, right? There was never that thing that was just amazing and did just good to everybody. So I think there are always going to be ups and downs. There are going to be failures. There are going to be major successes. There is going to be a journey, and the journey is made out of all the pieces that are part of any journey. So it's very hard to look and say that's how it is going to be in 20 years from now, especially when, again, if you look historically, from the moment the wheel was invented until the moment the car was invented was like thousands of years. From the moment the car was invented until the plane was invented was like dozens of years. And then to make a rocket, it was like another 10 years. And then, you know, so everything's getting shorter. So people ask me what's going to happen in 5 years. What did people that were in a job interview 5 years ago said when they were asked where they're going to be in 2020? Did they say, I'm not going to come to work?
Sitting at home in front of their laptop, waiting
exactly.
for a global pandemic to pass.
I'm going to sit at home, you know, work from my sofa most of the time. I'm going to be, you know, from my bedroom. I'm going to go to a walk with my kid because he's not going to go to school and all that. We can't know, you know, things are moving so fast. I think, you know, as meditation says, focus on the present and be in the present. Be present and be here. Yes, plan for the future. Make sure that the steps that you're building and everything has a plan. But first of all, live the present and be where you are and make the most out of it. So I think that's probably the most we can do.
It's interesting to hear you mention meditation as a form of biohacking. I just wonder, what has your spiritual practice informed in terms of the way in which you want to take the future of something like Cyborg Nest?
Oh, do you want me to tell you my life routine every day? So I wake up in the morning and then I do between 20 to 30. First of all, first thing, I drink a glass of water, and then between 20 to 30 minutes of breathing exercises, the Wim Hof method. And then from there, I jump outside into an ice bath that I have waiting for me and getting cold the whole night. And after that, I have my breakfast and with the kid and take a lot of supplements. So, but it's, it's, it's just a part of it's a part of who we are, and it's all going to combine together. It's not one going without the other, you know. Like I'm trying to explain, for example, to other people about the benefits of what this or that can do to you, but people still look at it as that horrible world of alternative medicine or alternative therapy. It's not fucking alternative. That's what it is. It's science and it works, right? I mean, we are just not used to it. But once it will, it slowly gets in, and we are very close to the moment when you're going to go to the doctor and the prescription that you're going to get is for 30 minutes meditation every day, because that works, right? If you want to cure your stress, it's not pills that are going to fuck up your brain. It's meditating, but meditating every day. Like you take your pill every day, then you do the meditation every day, and that is going to work, right? So it's all going to go to that place, and it's all going to combine together, and it's all a one unit that we all going to be part of.
In that case, if there's anybody listening to this podcast right now who've heard about Cyborg Nest and are excited about becoming a cyborg, or they're a wannabe biohacker, what advice would you have for them?
First of all, get in touch, drop us a line, be a part, let's do it together. It's about a community. It's not about a person. It's not about a group of people. Not for nothing, the company is called Cyborg Nest and not Cyborgs Forever or whatever, because we really see that as a nest, right? We see it as a place where people come and they feel comfortable, because the idea of a nest is that you're safe, you're comfortable, you're loved, and you're part of something that everybody does for the good and for the bad, you know? So it's just come, get in touch, and accept that. If you don't want to get in touch with Cyborg Nest, which is absolutely fine as well, don't be afraid. Just go and do that. Just go and you know, be responsible and don't do stupid stuff. But yeah, push those limits as much as you can while you don't disturb others, and you're going to get there, and don't give up.
I love that the emphasis is on the nest rather than the cyborg.
Yeah, it's you know, we so many times we thought of changing the name of the company, but every time we get to the place where we say, okay, we're going to change it, and then after 2 days we're like, nah, not going to change that.
Well, what's next for you guys? What's next for the Cyborg Nest? I know you have the new Centero device coming out now,
which we are so excited about, and we look forward to it, and we hope it's going to be cool. And yeah, there is a lot of I can't say, but there is a lot of stuff that needs to happen in the next year, or even in the next very few short months, that depending on the situation in the world, depending on financial situation and all that, we hope that we can make it all happen. But yeah, we have an amazing team. We have some world names that are going to join us very soon, and it's going to be exciting to work together with them. And yeah, the future is a dream, so let's make it happen.
Well, I'll certainly be looking closely at what Cyborg Nest brings out in the near future. And Livy Babbitts, I just want to say thank you for being on the Futures podcast.
Thank you for inviting. It's been a real pleasure.